Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Topic today again IC201. Today I will focus on the transmit path. Up to now I've checked more or less only the receive path. Okay, the FM transmit path was also checked. I had nearly 10 watts output, but the SSB or CW path I didn't check. So one of the most important things now will be a microphone. But before I connect the microphone and try SSB, I will have a short look into the brick, into the power amplifier, into this brick here, and remove the heatsink. A short look onto the heatsink shows 4 screws. 3 screws are identical. The 4th screw is a different type. I don't know why, but this shows me that somebody was in it before me. So I have to look what happened. Again, it seems to work because we have full output power, at least in FM. But now I'm a little bit curious what happened, why someone opened this screws here and has lost one screw and replaced it by another screw. And now some words regarding the electronic switching between receive and transmit of this transceiver. Other transceivers in those days had a so-called antenna relay. You know it. It makes click, clack, click, clack to switch over between receive and transmit. This transceiver here has electronic switching consisting of these parts here, especially these diodes here. How does it work? In receive mode, we have here plus 9 volt. It's pin A is coming from the connector. For this PA here, this is plus 9 volt here in case of transmit. And here this transistor, it's a PA transistor, gets it 13 volts by this connection here. And here we have capacitors which isolate between 13 volt and the 9 volt here in case of transmit. First have a look at the receive mode. We have here plus 9 volt and we have here 0 volt. So the receive signal comes in here. The first low pass here goes here through. Second low pass and comes to these diodes. These diodes are not forward biased because we have here 0 volt. They are not reverse biased, but it's not necessary. The input signal as a receive signal is so weak, it's not necessary. We are talking here about micro or millivolts. It goes up there. And this diode is also blocked because we have here plus 9 volt inductor. The plus 9 volt reaches the cathode via this resistor here. It's not relevant in this moment. This diode is blocked, so the receive signal can only go here to the attenuator, and in this direction here is the receiver section here. Again, receive signal here, 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 goes through there. Diodes are blocking. This diode is also blocking, reverse biased, goes here. Transmit mode, we have here plus 9 volt, we have here 0 volt. So the transmit signal, here's a driver, goes through the PA transistor, goes here through. These transistors are, diodes are biased in forward direction. The signal goes through to the antenna. In such a configuration, of course, there's a danger that a part of the signal is going here into the receiver and destroys it. This is a task of this diode here to prevent this. When we have here plus 9 volt, then we have here also plus 9 volt, and we have here 0 volt, because this is only in receive case 0 high, but in transmit case it's 0, so the cathode is grounded here and this diode is fully conductive. And if any RF signal, HF signal is coming through, it is shorted here via this capacitor to ground. So the input of the receiver is protected. So the transmit signal goes straight here through. And the part which would like to go through here is blocked by this inductor here, because this signal is not resonant any longer. This L12 and C37 is a resonant circuit. But when we have here a short circuit, It is not resonant any longer. We have only the inductor here, and the signal here is blocked. The receiver is protected. So transmit signal goes through without making any damage in the receiver. It's a very genius system, I think. It was in those days developed first by ICOM, as I know. If you have better information, please make some comments to the video here. It works still very good. I will check it, but as I have seen, I have full receiver sensitivity and full transmit power, so I think these diodes here are still okay. By the way, as I know, here's only one diode installed actually in this transceiver here, not two in parallel, but that's another topic here. The power is only 10 watts, so these diodes are not so highly loaded with voltage and current. For higher power, I think, for more power, it's not a suited circuit here, but for 10 watt, it's okay. I will check the PA brick, have a look at it. Maybe some realignment is necessary. By the way, we have here an SWR bridge here for metering forward and reflected power here. But it's a standard circuit and needs no further discussion. Here we have a close view at the PA brick. Driver, BIOS setting. This is a power transistor here. It's difficult to see. It's behind this braid here. It's screwed here to the chassis for better heat dissipation. And here we have the diode, which is a diode D3, which is in series with the transmit path here. And here you can see two holes for the second diode, but the second diode is not installed. We have only one diode to conduct the power. This one diode here, but it is sufficient. 10 watt is not so much. At 50 ohms, you can calculate it. A standard diode will survive it. Here we have a diode D4. And D4, this is a protective diode for the RX path. It is conductive when we transmit, and it shorts the output into the direction of the receiver. The receiver is connected here. That is this plug here. And here we have the other diode here, this diode D5, which controls the receive path here. Here we have the balance for the SWR bridge, and here we have two additional potentiometers here to adjust the limitation of the power and switch off in case of a bad SWR. I will have a short look at the settings here, whether it's okay. But in general, it looks good. There are no modifications seen, no repair attempts or other tampering here. I think it's quite original here. I don't know why someone opened it, maybe just for curiosity or so. So one screw has been changed, but I don't see any damage here. And up to now, I have seen the PA brick works in FM mode at least. So I don't think that there's a problem inside. And now, before I proceed with the work here, a short modulation test for the transmit path. Again, I've connected my power meter dummy load here to the output. I'm in mode upper sideband. And additionally here, I have my good old trusty FT290R here as a control receiver. I'm anywhere in the range of 144.570 or something like this. It is pre-tuned, and you see I only have a weak output power here in the moment. Should increase the gain a little bit. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Could be a little bit more output power here. Upper sideband mode. Okay. Looks good. The microphone test was not so successful as you have heard. Maybe I had some acoustic feedback, so I decided to make it in a different way here. I use my tone generator here. use a simple adapter here, feed it into the transceiver here, and here's a monitoring receiver, and then I can check all modes. I will start with FM. I have a modulation frequency of about 1200. Okay, I can leave it. 1300, anything, doesn't matter. The frequency is 144.500. When I switch it on here, I can hear this frequency. Also higher frequencies. I have to switch over the range here. 0.4. Okay, obviously FM works. It was a problem with the microphone I had and some acoustic feedback here. SSB mode. Go to S. Output power, okay, I can increase it a little bit with the microphone gain here. See it here. But in general it works. The power is very high here. Other sideband. The lower sideband, it works also. Okay. Maybe I have to readjust the carrier, the BFO frequency here inside the IF unit, so it's maybe a problem of the alignment still, but in general it works now. The output power is in SSB also. Okay, I can increase it 6, 7, 8 watts. Well, first checks are successful, but now in the first stage I can focus on the power amplifier. Now I will try to realign the output here from the PA stage here. There are some trim caps I have to control here. I use the mode upper sideband where I can control the output. For this purpose I've connected the microphone connector here on this side here. You can see it here to my tone generator. Approximately 1 kHz, and here I can measure the output power here, 20 watts full scale again, power forward, and then I will try to adjust these trimmers here. I'm using here screwdrivers. I need some screwdrivers with a metal blade because these trim caps here are rather hard to move. Plastic or ceramic screwdrivers will break here. So I need a short metal here, but when using such a metal you have to be very careful not to create a short circuit, because sometimes these trimmers are on 12 or 13 volt, and when we make a short to the ground, to the chassis here, then it then we have a firework. We don't want it, so a small isolation over it. Heat shrink tube is a fine thing here. Same applies here for the smaller one, which I have here. I also isolated it. The tip, you can see it here, it is black. Okay, let's try it. I just show you what I found. The trim caps were already okay. I show you only the effect. I switch on the transmit mode. The output power is approximately 3 watts. And I don't show you all the trimmers, but for example, this one here, I can adjust the output power a little bit here. Okay, but it was already in the maximum position here. All right, here, there are two small trim caps here. I only show you one here. It also has been in the optimum position here. By the way, the transceiver is set to 145 megahertz, exactly the center of the amateur range. I don't use full output power in the moment in SSB. When I increase it a little bit, I go to a higher input voltage I have here. But I have the feel there's a saturation anywhere else in the transceiver. Maybe there has to be one stage to be a little bit realigned here. Okay, let's switch to FM. I need no modulation here. I switch it off here. Then I go to transmit. Okay, it is 8 or 9 watts, what we had. I just try to increase the power with this output power. Maybe there's a better result here. No, it's the same setting here. And for the other, I have to be a little bit careful because the heatsink is not mounted, so the transistor may get a little bit hot here. That's okay up to now. No, it is the maximum here. Okay, I will look into the driver stages. Maybe the wattmeter is not absolutely correct here. It's a rather simple one, SW power meter. The next stage is I will look at the transmit mixer and the pre-driver stages, whether I can increase the output power a little bit. And now a small trick I want to show you. We have here some inductivities here, some coils. I have no idea how to align them. I have no procedure for it, but we can check whether we are on the in the right dimension here by simply inserting a ferret core in it. I have here a small tool here. It is a small ferret core here from I think it's a Neosit filter or something like this for VHF applications here for some 100 megahertz. And when I insert such a small core into a small coil here, then I increase the inductivity. Opposite test is I use here a small copper element. It's the center of a coax cable. I think it was a H100 or so. It's a rather simple one here, simple solution here. You see the isolation here. And when I insert this, copper will reduce the inductivity or the magnetic field, so I can make a rough check whether it's in the one or the other opposite direction a good solution. I will try it. It will show you what happens. Again, transmit. Here some watts. I found that this coil here, when I insert the ferret core, you see it on the output, it increases a little bit here. When I insert it too far, it decreases. When I tune this, I would have to retune the capacitors. I'm not sure whether it gets better or not. I don't do it. Here's no essential reaction here. It gets down here. When I insert the ferret core here, as you see. And when I try it with I use a smaller one with the copper here. You could also use aluminium. Then it... nothing happens here. When I take the thicker one here, it also drops, maybe the capacity is too high from this thick copper rod here. Okay, but this is a little trick to check inductors whether they are on the right range, and I think it's okay here. I don't tweak it. I have nearly full output power in SSB. I'm missing some watts, but I think it's a problem of the premixer or a problem of the first modulator, ring modulator or something like this, or amplifier stages. I will realign it. I just leave it. The next check is to look for the bias setting here, for the two pots here. Maybe they are not optimum, and I can squeeze out a little bit more power. And now the alignment of the SWR meter, the internal SWR meter in the PA. There's a rather simple circuit, a standard circuit here with two diodes, a small directional coupler here, this circuit here, and there's a resistor, 100 ohms, should be adjusted to minimum indication of reflected power when there is a load of exactly 50 ohms without any reactance, only 50 ohms real, but no inductivity or capacity. This is the auxiliary SWR meter, just for reference here. On the back side here, you can see I have a dummy load here. Here's a small mirror. With this mirror, I can watch the SWR meter on the front of the transceiver here. It is set to SWR metering, and I will adjust this trim pot here. This pot here is for minimum. This is a 100 ohm pot here for the bridge here. Here is a small ferrite bead, which is the SWR bridge here. Okay, I will adjust this resistor for minimum reflection. I check it here that the dummy load is okay. Then I switch it on. We have 10 watts here, 20 watts full scale power forward. Power reflected is zero. When I go to calibrate for SWR metering, then SWR is also nearly zero. That's okay. I see here the indication of the SWR meter here. And adjust it here. Sorry, I cannot show it. Maybe you can see it here a little bit, but it's difficult to see. Sorry, I made a mistake here. Okay, that fits. Go back to receive. No problem. The SWR indication can be calibrated or checked with a load of 25 ohms. So I will connect here 25 ohms. That means two times a dummy load, 50 ohms in parallel. And now a small check of the SWR meter at an SWR of 2. SWR 2 means load of 25 ohms or 100 ohms. I have chosen 25 ohms, which can rather be easily made using two 50 ohm dummy loads in parallel with a T-bone here, T-bone connector to the output of the SWR bridge, where is the antenna connected here. So we will get an SWR of 2. We cannot calibrate this bridge internally here exactly, because it has only one calibration point. This is a zero point here. The other, of course, is a 100% setting, the SWR set point. That's it. We will do it. First check I will do is a transmitter. Switch it on. Power forward 20 watts. Okay, it's not 10 watts, a little bit less. Now we have some reflected power here. When I go to calibrate, SWR calibration here, we see this setting here, calibration, of course. Sorry, I will make it a little bit bigger here. And then go to SWR metering. Then we are measuring here too. I will show it here. This figure 2 has a small line to the lower scale here. So for lower output powers here, there's a small L here. And we have to choose this lower scale here. The reason is the diodes internally here are not linear, of course. So we have calibration, okay, and then SWR, and then we have rather exactly 2, a little bit more than 2. Okay, some error is permitted. I see on the front here, I've set the SWR, I have to set it for 100%. For a moment, it is a full scale deflection here, yes. I have a full scale, maybe you can see it here. Sorry, you can't see it here. I will show it to you in a better scene here. This is not the optimum here. When I go to SWR here, it is closely to the 2 here. A little bit too less here, but it doesn't matter here. It is nearly 2. Okay. Let me see if I can. This SWR bridge here is not a precise instrument. It is good for indication, it indicates that there is something. It is good to protect the PA against too much output power in forward and too much reflected power in reverse direction for bad antenna and so on. But it's not a true meter. This is also not a true meter. It's a better meter than this here. But real good SWR bridges are made very, very better. Much better. Okay, that's it. I will check the output limitation now. There are 2 pots here. This to limit the output with bad SWR and with overload into a perfect 50 ohm load, not to overheat the power transistor here. I've connected now 50 ohms termination here on the rear side. Perfect load. When I switch on the transmitter again here, I can adjust the output power here with this pot here. This pot here is the limitation of the forward power here. And when you see it here, I will show you a little bit better here. So I can go a little bit less or a little bit more here than 10 watts. I come to 15, 13, okay, don't do it. I will limit it 10 or 11 watts, that's enough here. And now I will connect again the 25 ohm load. The output power limitation at an SWR of 2 is set again with these 250 ohms in parallel here. And there's a second potentiometer, this is a lower one here, which is connected to a output, power output limitation here. I can show it to you. It is switched on here. Here's output forward. Sorry, I have to feel it. It's again full power 10 watts. And you see suddenly the power is reduced. I go to approximately 5 watts, half output. When we have a bad mismatched antenna also, the output power is considerably reduced at once to protect the transistor. I don't know how good this transistor here is, what he accepts regarding overload and mismatch and so on. So I'm a little bit more conservative in the setting here. I make a recheck with exactly 50 ohms. And now the recheck with exactly 50 ohm load. And we have here 10 watts, a little bit more than 10 watts, as aligned previously. And in the other case, when we have 25 ohms, the output power is reduced to 5 to 6 watts. the bias setting of the two transistors here, driver and PA final transistor, can be done rather easily. There's a jumper. This jumper has two connections here. The outer one is the connection for the PA transistor, and the inner one is for the driver, and it sits here. I've taken it out, and then I can use an ammeter instead of the bridges here, instead of this connector here, and measure the current separately. Now I'm first at the driver transistor here, the inner two connectors here. I can adjust this pot here. I'm in mode CW, but I have a can't see it, sorry. I have here a dummy key in it to avoid keying. So it's open. I go into the mode CW, switch on transmit. But when there is no keying, then the output is zero. And I can adjust the bias without any signal. That's rather easy. And now I switch on transmit mode. And we have here current of 32 milliamps here, as you can see. That's okay. Between 30 and 40 milliamps, the current should be limited. I see it gets a little bit up, a little bit warm here, so I will reduce it a little bit. Sorry, wrong direction here. Okay, that's good. That's stable. I will switch it off here. Wait some seconds and see what happens again. 32, 33, okay. But hopefully it stabilizes. This driver transistor has no protective diode against thermal overload. It is shown in the schematic, but it is not existing here. Seems it was never there. But there is, it's not a big problem as I see. Okay, that's fine. And now I go to the power transistor. The connection now is for the PA transistor here, and the potentiometer for setting the bias current is this one here. A little bit difficult, you have to be careful not to touch the voltages here. The expected current, according to my experience, is 80-90 milliamps. It should be, I've checked it, it is okay in the moment, a little bit more than 90 milliamps here. It creeps up a little bit here. I'll just show you the effect here. Can set it down here. Okay, I leave it 85 or so. I think it's okay. My next check will be a dual tone check. With a dual tone, and to check the intermodulation of the transmit path, and maybe I can optimize these bias settings here a little bit to get a better output signal for optimum or minimum distortion. The work on the power amplifier is ready now. I've installed the heatsink again here for identical screws. I replaced the thermal compound here, wiped out the old one, used the new one here. The short plug here is installed again. DC bias is set. And now we can make some IMD measurements. Be warned, this PA here is rather bad. It's state of the art in the late or mid of 70s when it was designed. This was the age of good power amplifiers in the VHF range with tubes. Transistors just came on the market which could be paid, but they had a bad linearity. I tried to improve it by changing the bias and so on. No chance. I will show you the result. This is in line with my with my other IC201 I have, I don't get a better result here at an output of 10 watts, what is specified, but even less output power does make it really better. So it's, I think it's a problem of the PA transistor. The linearity is not good enough for this purpose here. There are better transistors in the market today, but it is again state of the art. I could not recommend, I wouldn't recommend to use a power amplifier behind it. This cannot be accepted. The signal is rather broad coming out when using SSB. I will show it on the spectrum analyzer. The test setup is rather straightforward as known. The transceiver, the output here is fed through this attenuator, power attenuator, 20 dB, another 10 dB. So totally we have a 30 dB attenuation. It is fed directly into the spectrum analyzer. The microphone input here is connected to this audio frequency generator here. It's a synthesizer. It can generate a two-tone signal. It has a very high quality output, a very precise and a very low distortion AF signal. I've set it to 800 Hz and 1400 Hz. So we have a two-tone signal and see how big the intermodulation is. This is a small potentiometer attenuator box. It's a little bit easier to use than this lever here. It's a little bit difficult for me. My fingers are a little bit too thick here. It's set in medium position here. And here I can move it from zero to maximum. Okay, now let's have a close view on the spectrum analyzer. Here we have the output of the transceiver without audio frequency, without modulation. This here is the carrier. We are in the mode upper sideband, so we see some noise here. We have 500 Hz per division, so we calculated 500, 1000, 2000, 2500 Hz. So this is the width of the speech or the noise of the filter, which can be seen. And now I increase the input, the microphone input here. A little bit less here. We have on top, we have a 10 dBm plus 30 dBm attenuation. Then we have here 40 dBm on the top here. 10 dB less is 30 dBm. That's 1 watt here. Both tones here have an amplitude of 1 watt. And we have here IMD distortion minus 20, minus 30 dB. That's okay, but 1 watt is not what is specified. I increase the output. Now we have 5 or 6 watts per carrier. That's totally 10 watt. And the IMD distortion goes down to minus 15 dB only here. So that's what I've said. It's a rather bad result here. I reduce it a little bit here to an acceptable level here, but again, as I told, please do not use a PA with it. The signal is rather broad here. Imagine this is a power of 10, it's 40, 30, 20, 10, 0 dB. This is 1 milliwatt here. And if you have a power amplifier by 10 or by 50 or so, then you have here 50 up to 100 milliwatts output with this unwanted signal here, and this is much, much stronger here. So you can imagine what happens on the band when you are transmitting with this transceiver and a PA behind it. So don't do it. I reduce the output power, the carrier balance. I have to calibrate to realign to zero. I just switch over to LSB, to the other sideband, and then you can see
Okay, it's, I have to increase it a little bit here. This is LSB, now the carrier is here. When I go back to upper sideband, then you see the carrier is again here. 500,000. So the 3,500. Okay, it's 3,500 hertz spacing here. Well, that has to be done in some other alignments. I showed you the spectrum of this SSB signal. Could be better, but again, it was state of the art in those days.